Good afternoon. Today I'm speaking with Anupama Kundu, who is an internationally recognized architect. Anupama has had her own office for about 28 years now, I believe.
And you now have, they're going to think I'm really old.
No, you are old. You started very young. And you have built over 100 houses, I believe, ranging from a mud brick house to a high rise. So I am curious about how do you assess your journey so far?
I would say that my journey has had a lot to do with not only what I did, but a lot to do with what I didn't do. I want to say that deliberately, especially in a educational context, because I think what you have the courage to say no to,
yes,
also shapes your career as much as all the things you do. And I think I do remember a lot. Like I think I had quite an idealistic, expectation of what mm-hmm. to do with my life. So mm-hmm. I didn't want to just look upon this profession as a employment provider or
sure.
anything of that kind. And so the more you see things going around, growing up in the context of Bombay, I saw a lot of those excesses and all those problems, which have only gotten bigger by now.
Sure, yes.
So I think I pursued a lot of, it took me a lot of time to do things, because I tried to think about also how the buildings are made, how they affect local scenario, you
mm-hmm.
know. So for me it was a lot about not only building buildings, but also
sure.
building knowledge
sure.
to be able to build the buildings. And eventually I also realized that you need to build community and build knowledge, because just the mere production of houses won't make it a nice housing, or it definitely won't lead to a better livable city
mm-hmm.
just by itself. So I mean, those kind of complex questions led me to produce the kind of work I did. I did do a lot of projects, but it's not like I did so many high rises, and I did a lot of unbuilt projects.
Okay.
So for architects, it's not too different, you know, to, I
mm-hmm.
mean, all the things that
yeah.
you...
Yeah, all of the work, the thinking needs to be
yeah.
in place, even if the project does
exactly.
not end up being built. Yeah.
So I think there has been a lot of research.
Mm-hmm.
My practice is very research-driven.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a lot of applied research that was involved when it came to this, like, you know, shaping some technologies and negotiating between high-tech and low-tech and figuring out for a changing landscape like India. And the diversity contained therein, you know, all these complexities. And it was about entering all of those areas of environmental, social and economic imbalances that
we live with. So sustainability is obviously a key word today in architecture. And you have, however, been practicing it long before it became fashionable. Do you think sustainability and globalized architecture can go hand in hand?
I think it's very dangerous to generalize on the other hand, because
sure.
I think sustainability for me is, it's not, nowadays it's kind of a new formula, no, new religion almost.
Right,
you know.
Right.
One could be meaning many things, you know,
mm-hmm.
like you have those green rating systems and you can come out with a certification,
yeah,
but when you go to the building and you say, how did that happen,
like,
you know,
right,
all those various boxes you check in don't necessarily guarantee that the holistic thing actually
so the standardization of sustainability in the form of
yeah.
kind of lead checklist
or
can sometimes
yeah the capitalistic forces that drive whichever thing, whatever is being called sustainable or not.
Sure.
For instance, I think the very fact that, you know, when people come up with a solar powered
mm-hmm.
vehicle or whatever, and you
mm-hmm.
call it, you have a new range of sustainable transport.
Right.
And you have the majority of the people in that area taking a bicycle.
Right.
They are not less sustainable, but they don't even realize are we sustainable or not. And I think what is interesting for me is again, to question what is not sustainable, that is something you can discuss. But to say that this is sustainable is not very scientific, because
right.
how much should one consume to be sustainable? We haven't defined that yet.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I think therefore all of these things, and unfortunately architecture prepares us to be site-specific, and I think everything
yes.
is very contextual and site-specific. And yes, I think very early on, because of the recognition of in the Indian context where I graduated at that time, we were aware already then that you know, the our population to resources don't add up if we
right.
were to waste, if we were to emulate the Western or the developed countries' consumption patterns.
Yeah,
we have too many more people on
right.
On our land to do that. So one has to
think about it.
So
earlier.
On one hand, you mentioned globalization and sustainability. So on one hand, the even the local needs are
mm-hmm.
not being met because of whatever, not only the old ways of managing resources,
right?
But then the capitalistic way of managing resources, that period we've been going through. And then there is the global demand. The globalization is creating an international standard of consumption,
right?
Which is way more, like, for example, in a typical Indian homes, you would have one room air conditioned, that too in a rich
mm-hmm.
Kind of household. And now everything is centrally air conditioned because the malls in other countries are that way.
I see.
So then it becomes a very complex thing. And then in the middle of all that, let's say the green rating system like LEED, etc.
Right.
Even when they land in India, and people don't want to think for themselves, they want to look at whatever standards and
yeah.
tick
yeah.
boxes.
Yeah.
It's very dangerous, because if you don't have an air-conditioned, centrally air-conditioned thing, you'll get some minus points for it.
I see. So it works in reverse
yeah.
almost.
Almost.
Yeah, right.
So these are so complex. So,
mm-hmm.
But yes, I must say that I did pursue the I followed the work of other people, but also I tried to, from inside out, think about how to consume the least resources and increase the quality of life.
Okay.
It was not for me like about not having this and not having that, but just to use what we have more intelligently.
Okay.
And to not create more problems than we solve that you see nowadays.
To be a good custodian of the land
of
and
the
of the resources.
All resources. And for me, time is also a resource.
What do you mean by that?
Because I think we are talking so much about resourcing, like resources as if it's external to us.
Right.
For me, my next exhibition hopefully is going to be called Taking Time. Because it's not only about slowing down, and the good aspects of slowing
mm-hmm.
things, but just like we talk about human scale in space, there is also something about the human scale in time. How much is it possible to do? And
I see.
Maybe because of, you know, as we are growing older, one tends to think all we have in our life is time. What else is? This is our most important resource. And we're spending it away freely, doing things we don't like necessarily.
Even though as we grow older, typically we are more strategic on how we use time.
Yes.
Mm, because maybe we know we have less of it, but
yes.
we tend to...
Yeah,
to
and that
be,
is a really
yeah.
big resource.
And
yeah. the second thing is, like, in when we talk about affordability in housing and so
mm-hmm.
on, throughout our lives we have given some time to the construction of our spaces, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Even birds and bees do that, you know.
Right.
But we now, what we call modern, a
mm-hmm.
way of doing things, everything has to go to someone in a big company somewhere else or whatever, and you are completely alienated,
right?
And you have to pay all the overheads of all those people and each of their bank loans and
right.
your own one as well,
right?
Ultimately
right.
the end user is paying all that. So it would be it's very important to use time as a resource, not only of the people who produce architecture, but the ones who build architecture and the one who are going to have to pay for that, you know,
mm-hmm.
there has to be a rethink, you
that's
know, I feel. So I'm dealing with time
okay.
also now.
Well, good luck with that. You are an Indian architect who came to Europe via Australia. Some students were curious about how much of your Indianness do
mm-hmm.
you feel like you have to exhibit when you are in Spain
Nothing.
Or when you are traveling?
Nothing. I don't want to exhibit any Indianness.
Okay.
I never had this pressure. I'm not, I didn't study, look, I didn't come actually via I didn't come via
Australia. Okay.
So what happened is I grew up in Bombay and I studied in a architecture school in Bombay. Most of my friends went to the US afterwards. That is a typical
for their master's degree.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I'm one of those who didn't want to just go on studying
without
you know, sort of imbibing more and, you know, I believe in a experiential way of learning as well. And so by the time, but I did want to learn, but you know, I took that into the field in a way in my research and later I went back to academia. But I went, the first place I moved to was Berlin. So I lived about 5 years there and I kept my office. I started a practice very early. So I had a practice, I was doing well. I did a lot of work and I kept getting opportunities to teach. So I was a kind of like, I was in a different position. So I saw a lot of friends who sort of went off and got shaped by other countries, like, you know, outside of the context.
Yeah.
Then you look for an Indian identity. You when you go back, you think, how am I going to apply this knowledge and all that. I don't have all that, you know. Neither I'm not a nostalgic kind of person. I don't think that everything regional is that good or, people are fighting.
You don't like the label critical regionalist as a way to describe your work?
Oh my God,
yeah.
you took that out of me. One day I'm going to have to confront that. No, because I think it's not about regionalism in the first place. My work has also come, you know, because it's normal to be, there shouldn't be an ism about being relating to your context. That's the basic thing.
Right,
so if someone, just because it doesn't fit in any other box and they don't want to call, I've been called all sorts of labels, like, what is that word? Something with vernacular, contemporary vernacular.
Contemporary vernacular, whatever that means.
What is it? I mean, I'm contemporary because I'm born in my time and I'm practicing in my time. And I'm not bringing, you know, it looks vernacular to someone whom that material suggests his own nostalgia or
their own experience,
his own anxiety.
Right,
I don't know. So I have a...
So there's a lot of projection into your work.
Yes. So for me, okay, so coming back to the Australia thing, so I actually got invitations based on my built work to teach in other contexts. So that made me, in the last 10 years, live in different places, including Australia, where I taught. In fact, before Australia and Berlin, there was a period in the US as well. I taught at Parsons. Later, I taught at Cornell, but that was once a semester. I was a visiting professor. And then, you know, the teaching trajectory, it was interesting because I think when I see the other Indians of my generation who are being known internationally, I think they've mostly studied abroad.
Overseas, yeah.
And maybe then there is that they have to go through that, you know, looking at rediscovering
India, like
and
that's interesting.
I
don't
know
that,
that. I don't glamorize. And it's everywhere I see the same problem, whether it's in Austin or in... Really, I really find what I learn here and there useful for everywhere. I think we are all Homo sapiens and we are all the same.
We all the same. We all have the same needs and demands and requirements. Your practice is known for doing a lot of material research, such as ferrocement. Are any of these available for on a commercial scale? Or is your interest just in developing the quality of the natural material for construction, not something that can become standardized or industrialized?
My interest is even not in the material, actually. My interest is in building the knowledge among the community, including myself and my interdisciplinary team, is that a lot of times you see people using things that they somehow know is not fitting.
Right.
They use materials from material catalogs because that's what is there. People are becoming more, architects are being more and more passive and becoming like puppets of whatever other market forces. So when I used to initially find that materials that people are choosing, those small micro decisions could add up to a disaster. And I would just think, no, I'm not going to do that. So, but in order to do that, you need knowledge, you know, and then that takes time. There is no shortcut. So I was actually, even with ferrocement and all that, what I'm chasing is actually, I did a whole line of research in terracotta. I've done things with wood. My driving force has been, how do I use significantly less material mm-hmm. to build the same amount of square meters given my context?
I see.
And that becomes an engineering challenge. So for me, the sustainability, the need to make things less unsustainable
right.
would be to use engineering knowledge to be able to use significantly less of whatever material you're using.
I see.
And because I see everywhere, I see wastage, or I see so much that this could have been.
Right.
And then I've chased the knowledge that led me right. to develop this. Now, I am definitely interested in mainstreaming those things.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why I moved into academia
mm-hmm.
and even in Germany,
mm-hmm.
Started collaborations with other engineers, and through the research potential of academia, which
mm-hmm.
I really believe in.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the only hope, because the market forces will never let you think.
Yeah.
But in the research conditions, if you create those conditions, you could actually come out with alternatives to those market forces.
It's very true what you say, how sometimes in architectural office, you come up with a design, you're thinking of a material, and then you stop and you look at the Swedes catalog, where everything is formatted, and you basically leaf through and you pick a material. So I think it's good for architects in school to know that it doesn't have to be that way, that this is just a very convenient arrangement.
I think especially it's an obligation in today's times to use materials judiciously, because for me, when I started out with architecture, I thought our principal job was to design the negative space, the void.
Right.
That's the only
right.
thing that's important.
Right.
We are going to use the utilities in the nothingness and not in the materiality. But then if you, and because it doesn't matter what the material is, if you realize that the materials we are choosing and how much of those choices feed the environmental damage
mm-hmm.
and health, as well, I mean, whatever carpets you prescribe and whatever. And you think that we did it so passively, we didn't necessarily decide all our options, but the nearest and the most convenient ones. And then you realize more and more people, you keep hearing like, you design an arch or a vault, or look at all the brick buildings. People are designing non-load-bearing brick
That's
buildings.
Right.
They're saying, oh, it's not going to stand. But then there's even here load-bearing buildings, and people knew how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I realized at some point of my career
mm-hmm.
that it's the reason why people aren't doing it is because they don't know anymore how to do it. And that was the most unsettling feeling. That's why I've called this building knowledge.
I see.
Because I don't mind if you have the knowledge, there is a catastrophe tomorrow, you will find a new way of doing it through first principles. I'm afraid about people in this generation if they don't know the first principles, because they're getting everything ready. Just like you have spell check.
Right.
Does it in the computer, great technology. Is it good for us if we don't know our spellings anymore? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I think about that.
So related to that issue, and as someone who has taught in a wide variety of context and in many different architectural schools, I was curious to hear what change you would like to see in architectural education to maybe better equip the student to address those issues you've raised.
One of the most important changes I would like to see is to see the academic hub as the brain or the kind of a thinking area of the city, not as a place to escape the city, not to come and be in one's own bubble
mm-hmm.
and become theoretical
right,
good, but
right,
not
right.
in the sense that it's cut off from ground realities.
Not at the expense of the city,
any ground reality.
Right.
So I would like academia, and that's what I try to do. I hope it will be seen in my discussion today. I feel that we have to ensure, especially with the virtual developments that we have around us, to ensure that the student has deep connections to ground reality and can nurture those kind of connectivities while being in academia, so that the ideas that are developed by them, being fully anchored in the ground,
right.
being even more theoretical, and then really making a difference.
That's interesting to hear, because as students now, students are exposed to such a a wealth of information that just kind of continue goes by your tablet, and being able to stop and kind of reground yourself rather than being transported into this multitude of references, it demands a lot of discipline.
And I think that there are some, like what I try to do is I try to, in the design studio, I try to have students have confront those kind of four realities. I call them real people, real materials, real scale, and real place.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you get out of any of that, and it doesn't, many people think, oh, it's going to be so hard to do something in real scale.
Right.
It's in 10 days or in a week, you can do, you can put up a tower that with you learn, you don't have to do it in exactly those materials. You can,
right.
What you need to confront, you should confront. Because you need to know the weight of things. Like you would never have a fashion designer making a wedding dress in silk when it's supposed to be in wool.
Right.
You
right.
never have those kind of models made. So sometimes we make those kind of models so small for so long, and we make anything cantilever, any amount. And then you start believing your own lies. After some years, it's a disaster. I think if you gently always keep that contact, then let them fly, you know, because then there's the confidence that you know you're confident because you have been always connected to the real things.
Mm-hmm.
At least basic things like gravity, we should not forget.
Yeah, we should, so of course.
So, yeah.
A final question I have for you is your relationship with Auroville and your interest in the architect who helped build Auroville, Roger Anger, led to the publication of a book a few years ago. Could you tell us a little bit about Auroville as a mystical town or as something? Is that something that could be reproduced in other places, or do you think it's very specific to what was?
It need not be reproduced. I think Auroville, I encountered Auroville after I graduated from Bombay and I was traveling around in India and I landed up, you know, finding out about it, and I realized that actually Auroville was a city that was grounded exactly 50 years ago. Next month is going to be 50. So it was an idea proposed under the now it's under the Human Resource Development Ministry of the Government of India,
mm-hmm.
but it was proposed by a visionary person who believed that there ought to be a place somewhere on the earth which it doesn't is beyond ownership, beyond nationality, beyond whatever, you know, social restrictions and mm-hmm. all of those things, so that a city that is a city that represents the common ground of human collective could be experimented through new models of education, economy, and organization and governance and everything mm-hmm. in an integral way. Sometimes it helps if, you know, pioneering people from everywhere come together,
right,
live together with the purpose of achieving a sense of human unity,
mm-hmm.
because of all those wars and all the troubles and that come out of lack of understanding between humans and other humans.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
this was very attractive project for me to go to, and on top of it the architect Roger Anger, who was given that project, I think I discovered through also meeting him and seeing his work, he didn't stop fascinating me even after he passed away. So I realized that whatever research he did is very useful for me personally with my concerns about social housing. I think housing is the key area when we talk about densities and with our population that's growing alarmingly and the rate of urbanization that is creating all the trouble in the world. He already addressed those problems long ago, motorization and all those things we've seen that, you know, he has started thinking about it long ago. But what I found most fascinating is his studies regarding loss of human scale.
Mm-hmm.
If you repeat monotonously housing and stack them endlessly above each other, what are the alternatives to that? And that question still fascinates me, and I still keep chasing it.
It's a good question, even here in Austin,
yeah,
where we see some development in,
yeah,
West Campus, and you wonder what is the architectural idea other than a structure that is a pure representation of developer-driven concerns
and
cheap construction.
This,
yeah,
what you just mentioned, the developer-driven,
right?
And this financial, the economic driver of things is responsible for many other degradations as well in society. You know, like,
right,
now, for instance, if I go to a hotel anywhere in the world, I already know what that person is going to wear in the reception,
right,
because it's,
right,
a chain. They're going to have that same uniform, and there is no way, you have everything's predictable, and it has entered every area, every sphere.
Yeah.
So I think that makes us humans feel like we might as well not exist. We are all the same.
Just passengers, as opposed to active participant in,
yeah,
a world of branding and, yeah.
And I think it reduces a human to a kind of common person. And we don't know anymore how to be natural and intimate. So I think what is worrying in all of these developments,
yeah,
and what Roger Anger researched a lot about, or predicted rather, is about the most important thing is the human. How is the human doing in all of this? How is,
right,
human society doing? Because there's the famous quote about how our cities, how we shape
we
our
shape
cities,
our
and
buildings,
the cities shape,
yeah,
us, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think it's high time we started speaking about how cities are shaping us back.
So great. Well, thank you, Annapurna, for
thank
this
you
very casual conversation. And we look forward to your lecture this afternoon on building knowledge and building community.
Thank
you.
Thank you. Sorry, it was a bit long. He asked me.